You know, here at MLB Trade Rumors, we love the pursuit. All the rumors, all the news, all of the analysis of what might happen. Different teams, different players. When a deal actually happens, it's sort of like getting a present on Christmas. So much anticipation, and then there's that moment when you unwrap it and find out what it is. And Yoenis Cespedes, man, he has just been giving gifts to us for his entire career. So many interesting storylines. We are going to cover those today. Please do run down below and subscribe because we have many, many more videos planned. Today, I want to talk about Cespedes, kind of a polarizing player. And I'm going to give you my hot take right up front. I don't think it's fair that he is such a polarizing player. I don't think that he's been fairly chastised for all of what happened with the ranch incident most recently. To catch you up, he was already sidelined after having heel surgery, was working his way back, and at his ranch, a wild boar charged him, and he ended up breaking his ankle. It was an unfortunate accident, but look, the guy loves horses. He owns a ranch. There's no indication that he was engaged in extremely risky behavior when that happened. That proved fodder for only the latest interesting contractual thing that happened in the career of Yoenis Cespedes, which was a renegotiation of the end of his four-year contract with the Mets. But first, let's back up. Now, Cespedes came to the big leagues back in 2012. Remember, this was when we saw a wave of MLB-ready Cuban talent flowing out of the island. It was kind of exciting from a baseball perspective because you didn't really know what to expect from all these guys. Many of them you'd heard of before. All of them were reputed to have great talent. But you didn't know what you were going to get. And there's some big money being thrown around. Guys like Cespedes, of course, but Aroldis Chapman, Jose Abreu, Yasiel Puig. All these guys got big contracts. So for Cespedes, who is 26 years old, you know, he was really a high upside play. Maybe not a guy you'd expect to go to a small market team. As it turned out, the Cubs, the Marlins, and the Tigers all reputedly were strongly interested in him. The Tigers dropped out after signing Prince Fielder, and then a surprise team came in. The Oakland Athletics swooped in, and it seems like they got him because they offered less years and still gave him the annual salary he was looking for, 4 years, $36 million, and that deal included a provision requiring that Cespedes be cut loose at the end of the contract. He also proved to be ineligible to receive a qualifying offer because of the way that mechanism worked. So they got him for 4 years, but they didn't get the full 6 years or nearly seven years of control that you can get over a player that rises through your ranks as a prospect. So where did the transactional history go from there? Well, Cespedes had an outstanding rookie season. He came in second in the Rookie of the Year voting. He dropped off a bit in 2013, but he was hitting well in 2014. Jaw-dropping throws from left field. Really exciting player. And so, hey, the A's were doing great. They're loving life here. You got Cespedes playing well, and they were making a real charge for the postseason in 2014. And then they went for it. Went all in by trading a guy who had just been named to the All-Star team. It was an interesting deal. John Lester, Johnny Gomes came from the Red Sox. Both of those guys were rentals. The idea, obviously, was to strongly bolster that rotation. You put Lester, who is then a mid-prime, top-of-the-rotation type of guy, right in there. But they sent Cespedes out to do it. So Cespedes heads out to Boston. It's almost hard to remember Cespedes in a Red Sox uniform, Lester playing for the A's, but it did happen for a few months. As it turned out, Cespedes really was not a great fit for the Red Sox, really didn't mesh there in Boston, so they turned around and swung another trade in the ensuing winter. A rare deal in its own right. You had two guys who were each veteran players established with 1 year remaining on their contract. Cespedes went to the Tigers, who had originally pursued him, and Rick Porcello, the right-hander, ended up with the Red Sox. Porcello signed a long-term deal with Boston before eventually signing with the Mets. So yeah, they're now teammates. Cespedes, of course, went to the Tigers and had a really outstanding first half of the year in 2015, and things only kept getting more interesting from there. Let's go back to that 2015 trade deadline just briefly. Do you remember Wilmer Flores, the Mets infielder, crying on the field after it emerged he had been traded to the Brewers, but then he never actually was traded to the Brewers like was planned along with Zach Wheeler for Carlos Gomez? We're going to do a whole separate video on that. That deal would have brought Gomez to the Mets, and they never would have got Cespedes in the first place. Instead, that deal collapsed. Cespedes comes from Detroit. Young righties Michael Fulmer, Luis Sessa heading to Detroit in that deal. Sessa's pitching for the Yankees now. It'll be interesting to see what happens with Fulmer. He had a great debut and has fallen off a bit coming back from major injury. So we'll see how that ends up working out for the Tigers. But it was great for the Mets. Even as a rental scenario, Cespedes hit a ton down the stretch, really blossomed into a full-blown superstar, led them to the 2015 World Series, but he was a free agent at season's end. The Mets were not able to offer him a qualifying offer, so they had no advantage in seeking his services to return it. As it ended up, there were a bunch of big-time outfielders on the market yet that year. That was the year of Jason Hayward. We just covered him in a recent video. Justin Upton, a lot of talent on the market that year, and Cespedes was hanging out waiting for a deal. You had some interest from the White Sox, the Orioles, and the Nationals were strongly pursuing him. At the end, it was the Nats and the Mets. The Nats deal had a lot of deferred money, even though it was bigger on paper, and the Mets swooped in with, again, a really interesting deal to get Cespedes. 3 years, $75 million, but that deal came with an opt-out provision after the first year. So Cespedes was able to earn $27.5 million in the first year. He had a great season yet again, and then head back to the market for another bite at the apple. This time around, you might have thought Cespedes would again take his free agency for a long run and try to really build up some bidding, but it didn't happen. He was the best player on the market that year. We predicted he would get a much bigger contract than he ended up getting. We thought he'd land something like $125 million. He ended up settling for $110 and did so before the month of November was out. Obviously, Cespedes felt comfortable in New York. The Mets were willing to commit to him up front. The Astros were named as a team that had some interest. Never totally clear how strong that interest was. 4 years, $110 million. And that deal was structured a bit differently. It was structured with a bit of a backload, so the end of the contract, Cespedes would be earning $29.5 million in his final year. Now, we all know that that just has not turned out as hoped. The Mets hit two home runs with the first two deals, and this one has been a total dud. Cespedes has actually hit quite well, just as well as before, about 30% above league average when he has been available to play. But he's only actually appeared in 119 total games since signing that most recent contract. He missed time in the first couple years, mostly due to leg injuries, hamstring. But then came the heel issue. He had to have surgery on both heels to address calcification. That was going to cost him much of the season anyway. Then came the ankle thing. 2019 was knocked off the books entirely. And that set the stage for this last offseason when we saw one of the most unusual negotiations that have ever occurred in baseball. And that was the Mets going after Cespedes for the money they owed him, claiming, hey, this guy was injured doing a non-approved activity. Obviously, Cespedes had not been acting within the confines of the contract in order to keep that guaranteed money, and was forced to take a big haircut on what he was still owed. So as it stands, instead of that $29.5 million guarantee for 2020, he's down to starting at $6 million. That will bump up to 11 so long as he's able to get back to full playing shape with the ankle thing and get to the active roster or hit the injured list with some different injury. So $11 million, he can get up to $20 based upon plate appearances, but still far shy of what he had been promised. We don't know how that's all going to look based upon the shortened season, but a very interesting twist and turn yet again. Hey, look, Cespedes is still 34 years of age. This story may not be over yet. If he comes back, has a big campaign, we might be looking at yet another interesting situation of a mid-30s guy with that injury history coming back onto the open market. Maybe we'll have to do another video then. We have plenty more plans, so please do run down below. Like it. Let us know your comments. What do you want to hear about? Thanks, as always, for tuning in. We'll do it again tomorrow.